Hello and welcome. You're watching Café DC and I'm Faiz Rehman. Today our guest is a young, accomplished scholar based in Washington, D.C., Moeed Yusuf. He's the director of Pakistan programs at USIP's prestigious, congressionally funded think tank. Today we're going to talk to him about several issues, including his recent trip to Pakistan. Moeed, welcome. Pleasure to have you on Café DC. So you just came back from Pakistan. And while you were there, of course, you also talked about, not officially, but informally among circles, and especially you were there to attend the Lahore Literary Festival, one of the very big events in Pakistan now, as well as in Karachi and Lahore. I think they're doing a good job. Your book, Pakistan's Counterterrorism Challenge. You know, let me show it to our audience first. And let's talk about this book first. It's in pre-order and it's going to be launched in April. So what's this book about first? And what you're hoping to accomplish through this book?
This book essentially came out of USIP's work. I mean, the idea came out of USIP's work in Pakistan, where, you know, everybody was thinking about terrorism. It's been 3, 4, 5 years, and we started thinking about this book when the SWAT operation had taken place, and after that, as things developed, because everybody talked about the military, and a lot of times one wondered how far the military could actually solve this problem, given that you have this problem in the cities, you have problems in courts of Pakistan, the finances that militants get. And so what I decided was to put together a somewhat of a star cast of people looking at various aspects of counterterrorism to look beyond the military realm. So here we've got chapters on Pakistan's counterterrorism challenge in terms of policing, in terms of the courts and prosecution, in terms of cyberspace, in terms of financial use, in terms of the political factionalism and disconnect, and a chapter on the military as well. And then Anatole Levin writes about whether Pakistan can survive this challenge. So it's a holistic view of counterterrorism. And if there is one point that comes out of the book, it's really that you cannot tackle this problem by taking one piece of it, only the military or only the police or only the legal. You have to look at it holistically if we have to resolve this problem. And interestingly, the book comes out at an interesting time because you've got the Pakistani counterterrorism policy. Finally, there's a strategy out in front of us which we can look at and review. And thankfully, it makes a lot of the points that this book makes. And of course, you know, these kind of books, the drafts float around and hopefully people pick it up and look at those. So the strategy does start talking about coordination, about holistic approaches, and hopefully we'll get there.
Actually, it's very timely in the backdrop of these talks that are supposed to take place. I mean, a lot of preparations are going on. So do you think what you have accumulated in this volume, do you think our leaders or negotiators will get some help? It will be helpful for them if they read this book? What is it that they can get something out of this book to help their job?
I think the point this book makes is that you can't look at something very tactically and specifically, right? So what policymakers would get out of this book is, where are the problems in curbing the finances of militants? Or what are the problems police is having? Or what are the problems in the legal criminal justice system? And how to resolve that over the long run? So this won't give them what to do tomorrow, but it will certainly tell them how to fix the problem over the long run. One of the things we've done here is got people who are practitioners in Pakistan to write. A serving police officer has written the chapter on the police. A Supreme Court lawyer has written a chapter on the legal side. And so we've got practitioners who know this business from the Pakistani side to explain to us what to do. To get the day-to-day and whether talks will work, for instance, there's another book that I'm coming out with in May called The Insurgencies and Counterinsurgencies in South Asia. And there we've looked at Pakistan, India, Sri Lanka, and Nepal, and tried to study since 1947 in Pakistan's case, in India's case, what approaches work and what doesn't work. And there I think policymakers will find two messages. One, talks in themselves are fine. There's no problem talking to insurgents, and you always talk to insurgents who are violent, right? That's why you talk to them. So this idea that they've killed a lot of Pakistanis, we shouldn't talk,
their weapons,
that won't work. So you have to talk to them knowing that they have a lot of blood on their hands. The other thing they will find is that talks will only work if either the state or the insurgent believes that they are about to lose the battle. So they want to save whatever they can out of talks.
At least one side believes that.
Correct. Yeah. And right now I feel that the TTP thinks that they are on the verge of a breakthrough rather than a defeat. My sense of the TTP right now...
And what makes you say that?
Well, look at everything they've been putting out. Look at the way they've been operating in Fatah. And of course, some conversations with people who should know this better than I do seem to tell me that they don't think that they have lost. They don't think that they're defeated.
But breakthrough is a very significant terminology that you use here. What kind of breakthrough?
I mean, breakthrough in the talks. Mm-hmm. Breakthrough in the sense that they will get space to survive mm-hmm. where they are. Look, they are not in a position to take over Pakistan or to do another SWAT kind of operation. What they are in the position of is holding on to some territory in Fatah, finding sanctuaries in Afghanistan, and continuing the violence in Pakistan to the point where Pakistan doesn't become stable and the weakness remains. And there, I think, they find that if they can talk to the state at an even keel, they may get a breakthrough. And thus, I think that book and my own sort of analysis tells me that the moment for talks is not right. The state may not be able to convince them on what they want to convince them on. So then I think the state has to decide. Does it still go through the process of talks and then say, look, we've tried and now we are going for an operation, or go for it early on?
The current moment is not right. Did we miss a moment in the past, near past, or are we going to have a moment in future, near future? Or look, no moments is the right moment?
Yeah, this is ironic. But look at what Pakistan has been saying to the U.S. in Afghanistan. Pakistan has been saying, you've got to talk to the Afghan Taliban because you haven't been able to defeat them. You're leaving. You need to get them in. If you want your terms to be met, the insurgent has to either have been defeated or be close to defeat in a way that they'll be in a position of weakness, right? At that time, if you remember, Pakistan used to say that talk and fight cannot work together to the U.S. Well, this is exactly what Pakistan will have to do now. It will have to talk and it will have to fight at the same time, because ultimately only fighting means a lot of backlash, and only talking means that you're giving them space for a strategic pause, unless you believe that they're about to lose, which I don't see to be the case. So I don't think we've missed an opportunity, but I certainly think that if we keep procrastinating without coming up with a clear strategy for the Pakistani state, you will have missed a few opportunities now.
Well, Moeed, you said this book actually came out of your work at USIP, mm-hmm. which is the United States Institute of Peace. Mm-hmm. This is a federal mm-hmm. government's institution mm-hmm. as a think tank. Mm-hmm. And you're a director of Pakistan programs, mm-hmm. very prestigious position. And congratulations. And we're proud of you, of course.
Thank you.
How did it come about, how you became director of this program?
That's an interesting question for more than one reason. You know, every time I talk to people in Pakistan, colleagues, friends, there's always this question. Okay, so they don't take any Pakistanis. There are very few Pakistanis around. We've got this Indian lobby. Everybody talks about that in Pakistan. How come you've made it? And you know, my answer is always fairly simple. Washington is a policy town. If you were in Washington, going through the system of education in this country, knowing Pakistan, having expertise, at a time when Pakistan became very important, 10 years ago, 7 years ago, opportunities were there. I think the think tank world here does value merit, does value expertise. It does not discriminate on the basis of where you're from or who you are. If they're looking at Pakistan, then actually getting a Pakistani is more beneficial because you can bring in a different perspective.
Absolutely. You're right? On the table.
Mm-hmm. Right. And you know, interestingly, this is probably the only time I remember in Washington that it's not one, but there are two directors of regional programs.
Shuja Nawaz
is another one.
Atlantic Council.
Who happen to you know, have Pakistani background. So I don't think it's that. Yes, it's not easy. But it's not because somebody is good and others are not that you get somewhere. It's because the number of positions in Washington think tanks are very limited. So one think tank at most will be having one person studying Pakistan, right? So if you count the number of think tanks, that's as many people as you can make it. So there's nothing more than meets the eye here. But it's certainly, it's competitive, but it's definitely possible. If I'm here and, you know better than average, I don't even pretend for a second that there was something special that got me here, to be honest. Yes, a lot of people say you're very young and whatever, but again, one good thing I found about the system, unlike...
What's wrong with being young?
Well, in Pakistan, there's tons wrong, right? You have to have gray hair to get somewhere. So, so here, I think I've never found a handicap because of age, to be honest. Maybe, I don't know what people would see this as in Pakistan, but in the US, I haven't found any real handicap here in terms of going somewhere. And so, you know, I think it's classic competition. And
you apply if you're successful, if you're...
That's right. And you have to be at the right place at the right time. And again, I don't want to say that this is that somehow I was, you know, better than others. That's not the case at all. It just happened to be lucky that you get there. And then just like in any other organization, if they find value...
I'm sure you're just being modest here.
No.
But Moeed, we have to take a short break here. And once we come back, we'll talk to Moeed about... whether it's a tenured position here at USIP, and a little bit more about USIP, what kind of work it does, and how many different programs from different countries exist at this institution. So stay with us, we'll be right back.
Each week here at Café DC, I go one-on-one. Politicians, literary giants, activists, power brokers, and many more from different walks of life. And focusing on what matters is my cup of, shall we say, coffee. Matters that make a difference in the society. Watch me, Faiz Rehman, on Café DC, every week only on PTV World.
Welcome back. Let's go back to Moeed. Yes, so your role at USIP, and I basically just wanted to know, is it a tenured position that, you know, you're going to be here as long as you wish to serve, or there's a term limit?
Think tanks don't, or institutions like USIP, which are not even classic think tanks, but do definitely have a component of analysis, they don't necessarily do tenure positions like universities do. So, you know, that is not the way they run business here. But if you look at think tanks around Washington, people tend to stay for a very, very long time. So these positions tend to be good till either the institute changes priorities or you decide to move on. So it's not a short-term position in that sense. But especially think tanks like in DC do not necessarily give you a tenure for a long term. It's based on funding. It's based on what you're doing. But at this point, as I see myself, I'm planning to stay put for a while.
I also came back from Pakistan a few months ago, actually, not as recently as you did. There's a perception in Pakistan, and you said Washington is a policy town. I mean, there are wonks walking around all over. There's a perception in Pakistan, there is a bias against Pakistan in Washington, especially in policy circles, legislature, academia. In that sense, you seem to be walking a very fine line, you know, and USIP, not a classic, you know, think tank, but still a lot of, you know, work that it does, does come under that, in that domain. Yeah. So, I mean, as director of Pakistan programs at USIP, do you see a bias against Pakistan? Is it that evident?
So let me say two or three things. This is a deeper question. So my remit is not only Pakistan, but South Asia. So it becomes even finer in some ways to sort of look at that. Bias may be the wrong word. But what is true is that in Washington, there's a certain narrative about Pakistan, which is certainly not welcomed in Pakistan, and which one doesn't agree with even sitting here a lot of times. So the whole point of the policy circuit...
Who came up with that narrative?
Yeah, so let me explain that. It's an important question. The way the town works is that you have experts who talk about this. The disagreement, the dissent, the opposite views are actually encouraged. That's the whole point of the debate, right? What happened in my view, personal view, over the past 10 years is that Pakistan agreed to support the U.S., but the strategic goals of the two sides never fully aligned, right? So both sides expected more from the other and were never going to get it, because I think at some point they were naive about what the other was going to offer them, right? And there, I think, the tension became obvious. Second, I think what has happened in Washington is that if there are 100 people who've spent time in Afghanistan and studied Afghanistan, there are 5 who did Pakistan, right? If you're in Afghanistan, if you live there, if you spend time there, if you understand what Afghanistan is thinking, Pakistan is seen as this country from where these people have sanctuaries, come in, blow up things, and go back. So you get a one-dimensional perspective. Now, there may be a large element of truth to certain narratives, but the whole picture on Pakistan, I can understand why Pakistan simply doesn't like the kind of narrative that comes out of Washington. So I don't think there was any design. I don't think this was done by somebody who thought that we want to malign Pakistan. But I do accept that on both sides, I think the narratives are somewhat further away from reality, somewhat simplistic, or much more simplistic than they should be for two countries who work together so much. Let me make one point on the fine balance part, and I think you were pointing towards sort of the personal role in terms of an analyst working here. It's tough. It's not easy at all, because you've got to see a person like me. Why does Washington need a person from Pakistani diaspora coming here and working on Pakistan? Because the idea is that you will be able to bring in perspectives which are both inside out, so you can understand as a Pakistani what Pakistan is thinking, and you can think of as somebody sitting in Washington or what the US is thinking. And then you could talk to each side explaining why certain policies may be in place, which others may not be able to grasp so easily, right? So that's always a fine line, because when you go to Pakistan, people think, oh, you're talking the American language. When you come to the US, people think you're talking the Pakistani language. And then, as you know, we have a hobby in Pakistan, which is blaming and naming people rather than talking about issues. And so if there's one regret, quite honestly, when you
say hobby, not a practice. Huh?
It's a hobby. It really is a hobby. I mean, everybody, you know.
Just to be fair to them.
Yeah. But I think in some ways, you know, when you say that, you know, people are proud of the fact that a Pakistani comes here and sits here. I only wish that actually Pakistanis were proud. So that objectivity, I think, gets lost when people use that to label and to sort of name and shame rather than talk about the views and the values of what is being put out. But I think that's the name of the game, and one shouldn't worry about that too much.
You mentioned about these roles not being very well defined. Mm-hmm. At the outset, mm-hmm. When they started this relationship, mm-hmm. a strategic relationship, they didn't know what to expect from each other, and mm-hmm. both of them, they just wanted more and more. Mm-hmm. So that means the area of cooperation wasn't finally defined. The least common denominator, so to speak, wasn't reached on both parts. Yeah. So whose fault was that more? Was it like the Americans that they just didn't communicated to the Pakistanis well enough and well in time that's what we expect?
Yeah.
Or were the Pakistanis just not clear?
I think first of all, neither side was clear on what was going to happen on September 12th, 2001. So when they came together and started working together, they weren't clear what the next 5 years or 10 years were going to look like. Remember, when this process of the Afghanistan campaign began, the optimistic view was that in 6 months, 8 months, this will be done. And so, you know, this is a very different benchmark. I think it was deliberately not spelled out. The lowest common denominator was not good enough for either side. And I think the worry was that if we really go too far in trying to define this, we are going to end up with the lowest common denominator, which neither side wants. They want more than the lowest common denominator. And so both kept it in the gray, kept working, hoping that the other side would see their point of view and help more. In fact, in reality, because of other policies, the U.S.-India relationship, Pakistan's relationship with China, and many other things, they started diverging more as time went by. So rather than coming together, they were pulling apart. And the more they pulled apart, the less the incentive was to spell out how they would help each other. Because again, the lowest common denominator wasn't acceptable.
Sitting here in Washington by the Potomac, you did mention your own opinion that this is not the right moment to talk to the Taliban, to the TTP. But is this an opinion or a position here in Washington that you come across a lot, that, you know, Americans aren't really convinced? What's their take?
Yeah, I think the view here, if I were to generalize, which is always dangerous, but I think the view here is even one step further, which is there's no point in talking, period. I don't think it's about the moment of time or how and when. I think the sense here I get is that a lot of people are wary that there were a lot of talks that took place between 2004 and 10. None of the peace deals held, the Taliban gained, etc. And so here I think people think that operation is the only way and talks are not worth pursuing at all. My view is that there may be a moment when it's right, and I'm certainly not opposed to talks, period. But this may not be the moment. But here, I think you go one step further, where the operation seems to be the real silver bullet.
Moeed, again, we'll take a very small break.
Sure.
And once we come back, we'll talk to you about the cynicism that has set in Pakistan, actually. About Pakistan-U.S. relations,
sure.
And they think that America is responsible for everything negative, possibly negative in Pakistan.
Sure.
So stay with us. We'll be right back.
Each week here at Café DC, I go one-on-one. Politicians, literary giants, activists, power brokers, and many more from different walks of life. And focusing on what matters is my cup of, shall we say, coffee. Matters that make a difference in the society. Watch me, Faiz Rehman, on Cafe DC every week only on PTV World.
Welcome back. Well, Moeed, there is a perception, a cynical perception in Pakistan at that whatever happens in Pakistan, America is behind it,
mm-hmm.
And most of the time it's negative. So, I mean, sitting here, both of us have been living here for mm-hmm. a long time. I personally don't see it that way.
Mm-hmm.
But as a scholar yourself, mm-hmm. As a director mm-hmm. of Pakistan programs mm-hmm. at USIP, what do you think? I mean, what's the reason for this cynicism and what can be done?
Dil ki tasalli ke liye ghalib ye khayal acha hai. I think when you get to a point where the internal problems are daunting enough mm-hmm. that you want to find other reasons, then the external actor becomes the obvious suitable candidate. I mean, Pakistan, I think, has been, in that sense, the narrative has been India-centric for a long time. Now it seems to be the U.S. Look, I think wherever there are problems in the relationship where there are strategic divergences, you will have some element of blaming the other. In Pakistan, it seems that we've gone too far, whereby, if you just want to talk about saying somebody else is bad, okay, fine. If that's what suits you, fine. The point here is that you can't go so far that you start overlooking the internal problems and the internal policy challenges. Talk to anybody serious in Pakistan and they would tell you ultimately Pakistan's solutions lie within Pakistan. Well, if that's true, then let's spend less time blaming others, which is not going to help you in any way, and try and figure out how to solve problems. That said, you know Pakistan and I know Pakistan. It seems to have gotten so far that now this is the evening conversation. Everybody is talking about it. So I find it very difficult to pull it back. The simplistic view I understand, which is pre-9/11, Pakistan wasn't in the problems it is. Post-9/11, it was. So look, the U.S. came and did something. That's not how policymakers think. That's how now, and that's not how it should be thought of. And so I can live with the fact that both sides have some angst. I don't see that changing. I cannot live with the fact that either side is absolving itself of doing what is needed at home because they're too busy blaming the other. And unfortunately, I think in Pakistan, it's gotten too far. Drones is a classic example. Every survey I look at, people who live outside of Fatah are more upset with the drones than people who live inside. I'm not saying drone is good, but that's not my argument. But my argument is I think Pakistan now needs to focus 100% internally.
But do you think the American policies, to an extent, have contributed to that perception, that cynicism?
Look,
I mean, is there any merit to those accusations and
look,
those
any time a state thinks that their strategic goals are not in line with another side, there is merit to that argument, right? So there is nothing objective due to which India should hate Pakistan or Pakistan should hate India. But because your strategic goals were opposed, that's where you ended up. With the U.S., the U.S. relationship with India may make perfect sense for the U.S., but if you're sitting in Pakistan, you are bound to look at it negatively if your view of India is what it is. On Afghanistan, I think there's been a disconnect. And I think both sides have a point of view, and it's irreconcilable because both think that the other has undermined their. So when you get to this stage, it is very difficult and in some ways irrelevant to try and prove that you are right and the other is wrong, because you'll never get to that. What you really need to do is say, okay, I'm going to continue having that debate, but I will not spend any of my constructive policy energy blaming the other when I can spend that time trying to fix things internally. In Afghanistan, I would say the same thing for the U.S. You know, whatever has happened, the goal is to fix things, and so whatever is needed for that, that's what we should do. The U.S. has come out and said, yes, in the 80s, there were ties with the Mujahideen, which may have now come back to haunt everybody. Okay, fine. If we want to spend 24 hours blaming the U.S. for that, that's okay. But when are we going to spend time trying to fix things in Pakistan? When is the U.S. going to spend time doing what it needs to do on policy? So my view is, I don't think anybody can win this argument. So let's drop the argument or have it on the side, but let's focus on the policy path first.
At the end of this year, 2014, is going to be either total or nearly total withdrawal from Afghanistan. Yeah. Do you see Pakistan-U.S. relations improving or having an adverse effect?
It's one of those marriages where childcare is too expensive, so divorce is not an option, but it's one of those where you simply can't get along. And so I think you're going to have that tension. It's not going to be a pretty relationship. At the same time, both sides know they can't do without the other. Problems in Pakistan are going to remain for some time. The nuclear weapon issue is there. U.S. role in South Asia is there.
Sorry for the interruption. Mm-hmm. If the U.S. exercises this zero option in Afghanistan, and if it's a complete pullout, not mm-hmm. just from Afghanistan, mm-hmm. but from the region, mm-hmm. do you think Pakistan will remain as strategically important as it is right now?
Pakistan will become more important because the problems in Afghanistan are also not going anywhere. So if this is a franchise model where everything is out and then you have to work with local partners, the partnership of Pakistan is going to remain crucial, especially the Pakistani military in some ways, right? But even if you come down to a number which is what is being talked about here, a few thousand, still doesn't change anything. I think both sides know they can't do without the other. Yes, you will not see Pakistan in the headlines every day. You will not see the U.S. in the headlines every day in Pakistan. And that, to be honest, may be a good thing, because the more the visibility, it seems, the more angst, the more tension. So a lower keel partnership, but substantive one, I think, may be a better way to go forward.
Moeed Yusuf, it's a pleasure having you on the show. Pleasure. Thank you very much for your candid thoughts.
Thank you. Hmm?